morning.
Last time we looked at the blue force, and when we looked at the blue force, we used the blue law, and the blue law was telling us about the two charges, Q1 and Q2, if there are distance higher between them. The blue force was proportional to the the product of the charges, inverse of proportion to the distance between them. And because we say during this course we shall be interested in the vectorial analysis, then we say that we will be able to have the direction also of interest to us. So we put the vector on our blue force. And if we put a vector, then we show that direction by using the unit direction vector that. And then the proportionality constant we say is about 1 over 4 pi side of half. And depending on how you take it, whether it is from you have Q1 and Q2, if the distance between them is the error that we have talked about, we can always show the direction by understanding where we want the force to move from to. So if I want to talk about the force exerted by charge 2 on charge 1, that means that force would be in this direction. And this distance here, R12, if we get the magnitude of this vector here between them, divided by the magnitude, then we get the unit direction vector. So the unit vector just helps us to know where a given vector is going to, because it has only a magnitude of 1. It's not going to change anything. Just to show us where it's going. And then on this other side, if we were to talk about the force on charge 2 due to charge 1, then we will have this one here as the indirection vector from 1 to 2. Whereas this one is from charge 2 to 1. So this would be 2-1. So you can see we can have two blue forces on this same set, where this is 1, 2 equals 1 over 4 pi, epsilon naught, and then we have Q1, Q2 over R12 square, and then we have the R12 rule. Whereas this other force here would be given by F21 equaling to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, Q1, Q2 over R21 square, R21. So basically, from the charge as a principle or as a keyword for our course, when you have one charge, you produce a field. When you introduce another charge, you create a force between them. If you have a bunch of them, you create a force that you can get by using the superposition principle. And this one can be done when you have the discrete number of charges. And then we went ahead and looked for when we had a volume, took an elemental volume, we took a surface, took an elemental surface, and took a line, and took an elemental. An element of that. And then each of these elements gave us a elemental charge. Which elemental charge acted as Q1, and then we got a Q0 here, which we now analyze with the elemental charges. And then we ended up with an integral whereby the force was the same as 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, the integral dQ, Q0. Over R squared and a root for any point P where the charge Q0 was placed. 1.4 are what examples then 1.4.1, we're gonna do an example of the line charge, or I mean a linear charge distribution. And much as you have been wondering what kind of linear charge could be, we shall take a ring. How many of you have rings?
I got none. I don't put on jewel on my body. It's forbidden for me to put any metallic thing on my body. The belt is not on my body, it's on my trousers.
So we shall take the charge, and sprinkle it uniformly, and distribute it along the circumference. Along the circumference of the thin ring, the radius of the ring is small n, and the charge density is what you have been using. And the charge density is lambda Coulomb per meter. So consider a point charge Q now. Consider a point charge Q naught at a distance x along the axis of the ring. Then we have the center, and along the axis of the ring, a distance x here. We're going to have our charge Q naught, and then it has radius A. So this is the then this would be, for ease alienation, we shall say that this would be along the y-axis, and this is along the i-axis, just for alienation, to know where we are. So as the board is, and as how the ring is drawn, so this is our ring, okay? This is our ring here, and all I'm doing is to put it there. That's why it is having that kind of shape. And along the axis, around this point, is where I'm placing Q naught, a distance x from the ring. And after doing that, but the center has no issues. The center has no charge. The charge is sprinkled along the ring. So I cannot say I'm gonna look for a metal charge in here and then compare it with here, and because I know x, then I find the Coulomb force. It must be what is producing the elemental charge that actually I consider. So this is a section here that will be our dA, and from there I can go the charge. And if this is the distance from the elemental charge on the ring up to the point charge Q naught, This will be Arab roof. On the other side, also we have another element for easy handling. So there's an element here, there's an element there. This wing has been chopped, can be chopped, or psychologically or theoretically we are partitioning it into small pieces. But the most important two pieces that we want to consider now, this one and this one here, for purposes that you're going to see in a short while. So I got the distance here also. We have other roof here, and also this is R, because they are symmetrically the same, R, R, so the R roof, R roof. So if this is theta, of course this will also be theta, and also this is theta, and also that is theta, geometrically. So the ring has charge density lambda rho per meter. There will be a force due to this element here, and it will be elemental force. So this is F. It's the force, the rho force due to this element on this point charge Q now. And that's why we call it F. It is elemental rho force. Similarly, this other element here will also give us an elemental force, df. So the force on Q naught, the point charge, due to the elemental charge, dQ, which is equal to lambda dF, is given by elemental force is equal to Q naught over 4 pi epsilon naught. I don't have this here, but which is Q1 is Q naught. Q2 for the element is the dQ, which is the elemental charge. So it will be dQ over R squared, R roof, and we shall have the end there. So when we have discrete charges or variables, whether it is in probability theory, discrete both for summation and continuous, you cannot really integrate. So you stretch, I think I said it last time, you stretch the summation sign from the integrating sign. So this is our force, elemental force, but which we can go further and now substitute for dQ, because this is simply the Coulomb force between this element here and this charge Q now, whereby this element has charge dQ. So this would imply that dF is equal to Q naught over 4 pi epsilon naught integral lambda dF over R squared R roof. Now, the element on the top will produce a force, okay? This element here will produce a force, and that force will be along this direction. This element at the bottom here will produce a force, which will be along that side. And a bunch of others also produce, so this one produces that force. This one, this force. This one, this force. This one, this force. This one, that force. This one, this force. Of course, all intersecting at the point where we have our Q now. To get the resultant force,
due to these other elemental forces, that means we have you have to divide the force or to resolve the force either vertically and horizontally. And then you find the resultant from the Pythagorean theorem of these two other forces. So as you can see, all the vertical forces, all the vertical components, once this force is this way and you get its vertical component, that component will be opposite to the one which is here because it will be up. So this element here is producing a vertical elemental force facing down here. This element here will produce similar force upwards here, and these two will be just opposing each other around the vertical or around the vertical plane at the point of here, at this point here. All these forces, when you resolve them, they will be equal poles. The one down has an equal one up. The one this side has an equal on this side. The one here has an equal one here. And they will end up having no effect on the charge. So the vertical components of the forces will not have any effect. They will be equal, opposite, and canceling out each other. Only say that along this plane, this body is a vertical plane, but if I can use this paper along this plane, any of the forces due to the elements of this whole ring, this one here produces the force, the other side, it's the sum of the components. Of the forces on Q naught along the vertical axis, that is the y axis, which is where the unit vector j is along, is zero. This is because of their diagrammatically opposite elemental charges giving rise to exactly opposite components of the force along the vertical axis. I think we use the vertical plane, not the vertical axis. Because when we say axis, yes, even this one is the vertical axis, but now this one here, we are talking about this component out of the board is no longer the one, because we have elements all along the ring. So if I only say the vertical axis, it means I'm meaning this one down and that one up, much as, but along the vertical plane, all the forces, they are grammatically, you find that one in, one out. The other side is another on this side, all along the vertical plane. Let's
The result and force. On Q naught is given by F is equal to Q naught over 4 pi epsilon naught integral lambda Vm over R squared. And then the component of the force here, the horizontal component of the force will be, this is opposite to this here. So to get a component along the I here, this is the I, we shall get the cosine. Collapsing the angle, we get the cosine. When we stretch, we get the sine. But the stretched one already cancelled out, so we are interested in this one here. So this would be cos theta, and then to now be along the I. So we are not interested in the other roof anymore at this point. After understanding that the forces in the vertical are collapsing, cancelling to zero, we remain with the horizontal ones, and we take one of them so that when we integrate eventually, we get all of them along the ring. So now this becomes a piece of cake, but we are talking of a ring. And the only things they gave us was the distance from which along the axis the charge was placed from the ring. They also gave us the radius of the ring. And those are the things that we can use in our expression for the proof force. Otherwise, we don't know no cos theta, and we don't know the air. It's still something that we should find out. And we can find the air because we can, the air means that to get the total length, we go along the circumference of the ring, and if we finish it all, we can relate the circumference of the ring with its radius. So that means we need to know or to use geometry and find out what theta is in terms of the parameters we know. That is x and a. So now from geometry of the figure, not of your linear algebra or your calculus or mathematical methods of physics, then we can say that cos theta is equal to the adjacent of the hypotenuse, where adjacent is the side near the angle. So this would be x over r. So since R is part of the geometry, we can now find out actually the whole thing. So this would imply that cos theta over R squared would be the same as x over R cubed, which would be the same as R can be expressed in terms of the ring's radius as well as the distance from the ring. So this would be the same as x, please ignore these other parts of the wall. So this would be x squared plus a squared to the power half for half, and then when we chop it, we get 3 over 2. So that is our cos theta. Yes? This one here is square here. Because I'm just picking these things. So this implies that or whence our F here will be the same as Q naught over 4 pi epsilon naught. Then we integrate. Our lambda is the charge density, it's a constant. Our dl is a constant. And then we have our cos theta of r squared, which has simply become x over x squared plus a squared, the 3 over 2, and the force is still along the r. So we got the r here, and this is because we already baptized this as a vector. So this would imply that f would be equal to q naught over 4 pi epsilon naught. We now become a bit realistic. Lambda is not changing, it's the charge density. X is where we placed the charge, it ain't changing. A is the radius of the ring, it ain't changing. So they are more or less all constants except the elements that we chopped through here, that we gotta add up all through to finish the circumference of the ring. So that means I will be able to have the lambda x over x squared. Well, some students ask me why I write different x's. So let me try to make sure they are uniform. A squared 3 over 2 integral dl along the r. And if when I partition this ring here, it means I start from where I got nothing, no element. So I get the first element, I go all through until when I finish the whole ring. So from zero, what is the total circumference of the circular ring? 2 pi the radius, and the radius here is A. At this point, you are geniuses in mathematics, I guess. So with your mathematics plus the mathematical methods of physics, then you can find, we no longer need this depth. So I can chop it off now. F will be equal to Q naught lambda x over 4 pi epsilon naught x squared plus a squared 3 over 2 L 0 to 2 pi A. This would be along the I. This would imply that the force would be equal to Q naught lambda x over 4 pi epsilon naught x squared plus a squared 3 over 2 2 pi A along the I. If you want to do the simplification, you have the pi's going, the 2, and then you remain with the therefore the Coulomb force on a point charge Q naught plus the distance x from a ring of radius A having charge density lambda Coulomb per meter will be the same as Q naught F will be equal to Q naught lambda AX over 2 epsilon naught in x squared plus a squared 3 over 2, and that force will be along the I direction. Because everything along the J is diagrammatically opposite, and it will cancel out inside. The risk of getting something damaged, I'll still use this. Forget, just make sure your eyes don't see this part here, but sees this as a ring. Okay? And then we have our elements here. These are the elements that we chopped on our ring. And then we had to look for the total distance or length along the thin ring.